I'm going to spend 20 minutes or so talking a little bit about peer review. I'm going to walk you through the results of a study that Elsevier did in collaboration with a third party, and also give you a quick overview of some of the initiatives in peer review that are taking place in the publishing industry. Now, peer review has been around for quite a long time, really kind of emerged with the advent of scientific journals back in the 17th century. And the philosophical transactions of the Royal Society is largely accredited as being the first journal to introduce peer review. But it's not really until after the Second World War that peer review becomes formalised and becomes quite commonplace. And such is its position today that in 2009, 1.4 million research articles were actually published in peer review journals. And you just kind of like pause and think about that for a minute or two. That means that an article is peer-reviewed and published about once every 22 seconds. So over the last 50 or so years, we know the kind of publishing of research articles is extending at about a rate of about 3 or 4% per annum. So we know the pressure is increasing on the system. And when you think about the average article, it takes about 2 to 4 hours for a reviewer to review, you get a real sense of the scale of peer review. And I think, really, it's because of its scale and its value to the community that it's actually been questioned by members of the community, something that Mark rightly pointed out. So there's a perception there's been an erosion of peer review, perhaps that it's holding back innovative research, that there are too few reviewers, and those few reviewers are really overworked, and that perhaps it's not really improving the research articles that go through the peer review process. And really, it's not particularly good at stopping plagiarism. So what we wanted to do was really get a deeper understanding, but we have to understand that it's not only the community that are the research community that's questioning peer review, it's actually entering into the broader media too. So Mark mentioned an article that appeared in The Guardian, it was only a few weeks ago, where they talked about the corruption of science via peer review and the publish-or-perish attitude that exists in the scientific community. I particularly like this other quote that we got from The Independent from about a year ago, where they say that peer-reviewed journals aren't worth the paper they're written on. And that was done. That came from Nigel Hawkes, who's the director of Straight Statistics. So there's a lot of heat and a lot of debate about peer review, not only in the research community but in the public generally by the various outlets. So what I want to do is to kind of get together with an independent organisation, Sense About Science, really to do a study on peer review. And what we want to do is to actually speak to the people, the individuals, the researchers and reviewers that are conducting review and actually benefiting from peer review, to understand what their thoughts are about the process. So in the tail end of 2009, we completed an online study where we received over 4,000 responses from the research community. Now, it was a large-scale study, and it was very representative, and it was relatively robust. And it builds upon a previous study that was actually done by the PRC in 2007, which Mark actually played an important role in. So what I want to do is to talk through the results of this particular study and give you some of the kind of key flavours, some of the key findings. So what do researchers think about the peer review process? Well, broadly, they're satisfied with it. The current system, they're relatively happy with. 69% were very satisfied with the peer review system. And we actually see that this has actually increased comparative to the 2007 study. It's actually gone up by 4 points. So, whilst researchers generally tend to be happy, what do they perceive the main purpose of peer review is? So, on this next slide, you can see that there's quite a lot of expectation for peer review to fulfil perceived various different functions. And what we see is the very dark blue bars identifying what they think peer review should do. So very much at the top of the screen, we've got they believe that it improves the quality of the published paper. That's what their expectation is, that is what it should do. Then we find that it's, it helps determining the originality of the manuscript. They want it to do that. And what we see in the light blue bars just underneath that is its ability to deliver on these different functions. So in terms of improving the published paper, it's not too bad. Most agree that it does do that. perhaps where it's less less than perfect is in terms of determining the originality of the manuscript. 64% agree that it does that. And as you go down the chart, it actually you see the gap between expectation and its inability to deliver on these different functions increasing. So in terms of determining the importance of findings, most believe that it should do that, 84%, but only 58% believe that peer review is able to do that. And where the gaps are really largest is in the expectation for peer review to detect plagiarism and detect fraud. And there's a kind of 40-point gap between the expectation and the ability to deliver. So it's clear that peer review is not really the panacea. So it's kind of tempting to think that really it's quite flawed in some ways. But when you ask researchers with, whether without peer review there'd be no control in scientific communication, 84% agree. So they believe fundamentally that it's an important process, even though there are some restrictions on peer review. Most believe that scientific communication is greatly helped by the peer review of published papers. And generally, there's a sense within the community that it's really quite well understood as a practice. However, what's quite clear is that they're rather divided about whether or not peer review is the best that we can achieve. I mean, they believe it's fundamentally sustainable. Only 19% believe that it is unsustainable. But this real issue of whether it can be improved or not, and we heard Mark mention a few different options in terms of what different publishers are experimenting with. Well, in this study, we kind of probed some of these new initiatives to get a better understanding. So when we think about the different alternatives, for example, usage statistics, replacing peer review with usage statistics, the perceived effectiveness of such an approach is really quite low. You can see this at the bottom of the slide. Only 15% believe that you could replace peer review usage statistics. In fact, the kind of new alternatives, such as open peer review and supplementing peer review with some kind of post-publication commentary, don't get any higher rating, really, than the traditional approaches, such as single-blind peer review. The one that really stands out as being perceived as most effective is double-blind. 76% believe it's the most effective form of peer review. And that's actually increased by 5 points since the study that PRC did a couple of years previously. Okay, so on this next slide, we wanted to understand really what peer review is doing in terms of affecting behaviour. And here we're looking at submission behaviour. So the ability, the facility for an author to submit to a journal, which is operating at different types of evaluation. So very much at the top, we see that single blind, it has a very positive impact. So if a journal offers single blind peer review, whereby the identity of the author is known to the reviewer, but the reviewer is not known to the author, most of the community believes that's where they're going to likely submit their next paper, 91%. In terms of double-blind, interestingly, given that it's perceived as being the most effective form of peer review, the number is slightly lower. It's 82% are likely to submit to a journal that operates that kind of peer review. And then the next battery of statements, they're all different flavours of open peer review. So at the very top of that section, it's the kind of most narrowest form of peer review, if you like. So that's where the author and the reviewer know who one another are. So here, 48% saying they're likely to submit to a journal that offers this type of peer review. And as you move down, you've got the reviewer's name being published next to the research article. 45% saying they're likely to submit to a journal that offers that kind of evaluation. The next one then is a report being posted next to the published article, but the name of the reviewer and being hidden. 35% saying they're likely to submit to such a journal. And then finally, the most transparent, if you like, which is where the reviewer's report and the reviewer's name is published alongside the article. And here it's 29%. And as you move along, you just see the amount of people saying they're unlikely to submit to such a journal increasing. In terms of the final one, in terms of post-publication assessment, if you like, and commentary from the community, there are two different types here that we looked at. The first one is supplementing existing peer review. So it adds on to the end of the process after publication. So broadly, the 45% of the community saying, yeah, okay, that's good, we don't mind that, that'll help. But when you think about replacing peer review with some kind of post-publication assessment on its own, most disagree, 68% disagree. So it's very clear there's an impact on behaviour when it comes to submission, depending on what type of peer review is offered. When it comes to reviewing, I don't know, do you have any expectation as to whether it would be markedly different to behaviour as an author? Anyone care to guess? Well, it's kind of, maybe it's not much of a surprise, but it's pretty much exactly the same. So reviewers, researchers, authors, they pretty much think the same way, as it seems, about peer review. And I have to admit, this kind of surprised me in some areas. I expected open peer review to have perhaps a bit more of a negative impact on reviewers, because they've got more to lose. And it does slightly, you know, the percentages are a little bit higher, but broadly it's pretty much the same. Now, it's important to note that this bit of analysis is actually based on another study. It's not the one that we did with Sense About Science, but it's relatively robust. It's based on over 2,700 responses. Okay, in this next slide, we wanted to understand better who bears the burden of peer review. We saw at the very start that it's a massive undertaking. And what we've plotted here is for the top 10 countries, the global proportions of papers from those countries. So we have, for example, China that produces 13% of the world's research articles. And then on the y-axis, we've plotted the amount of reviews that come out of those countries. So ideally, you know, you'd want all the countries beyond that line running from the bottom left to the top right. But clearly you can see there's two anomalies. So we've got the United States, which produces 20% of the world's literature and is responsible for something like 32% of the reviews. And China is producing a lot less reviews than it's producing papers, substantively less. So before we judge China perhaps a little bit too harshly, I think they're not contributing, it's worth remembering that, you know, we asked a question in the Sense About Science study about how many times a reviewer will decline to review in a year. And what we've got plotted here is, again, these top countries. And we can see the overall global average is 2.2. And we see that China is 1.5. So it's actually below the global average. So that suggests, rather than Chinese reviewers being unwilling, it's perhaps that we're not actually asking them to review as often as we should. Okay, so that's a really kind of a quick top-level view of some of the key results from the study that we did with Sense About Science. What I want to do the next few slides is just walk through some of the various initiatives in peer review. So in this first slide, we're going to look at open peer review and just give you a sense of which journals, which publishers are offering it. So BMJ have been running open peer review since 1999. And it's probably the most narrow definition of peer review. That's where the reviewer's identity is only known to the author, but nobody else knows. The readers don't get to find out who the reviewers are. And then as you move down, it gets progressively more open. So Frontiers and Biomed Central release the reviewer reports, with the names of the reviewers. That's certainly what Biomed Central do. Frontiers, they just put the name of the reviewer next to the paper. And then finally, at the bottom of the screen, we have perhaps a little bit more of an experimental approach where reviewers and readers are invited to comment on papers, and this is done by Biology Direct and Atmospheric Chemistry and Physics. And last year, Shakespeare Quarterly, so the social sciences aren't being left out, they've been experimenting with open peer review. And and in each of these instances, the attribution, in terms of the reviewer revealing their identity, is left up to the individual reviewer. Biomed Central, I think, tries to encourage the reviewers to always reveal their identity. So what are the experiences? Is does transparency always work? So it's interesting to note that BMJ published a paper in 2010 where they tried to experiment with the open peer review approach. So they had basically two groups. One group was the intervention group and the other was the control group. Both sets were obviously invited to review a manuscript, and after they agreed to review a manuscript, the intervention group was told that their review report could well be published alongside the published paper. And what they found is that 55% of the reviewers that were approached to take part actually declined to review. So for those of you who can remember quite well, that matches exactly the statistic that I showed in a couple of slides ago, where reviewers declined to review when their report was going to be released was also 55%. And what they also found was that there's no statistical difference in between the quality of the reviews by those or by those reviewers that had their reports their identity revealed and the control group. So there's a question as to whether that improved, that it was more effective. And what they did find out is that actually it took an average of about 25 minutes longer for a reviewer report to be completed. It's difficult to know whether that's because they're spending a lot more time improving the quality of their reviews or tidying up their English. It's difficult to say. Okay, so then there's atmospheric chemistry and physics. They have an unusual approach to peer review. It's very open, it's very collaborative, and typically the community is involved in the process. 4 to 5 comments per article, of which about 1 in 4 papers receive a comment from the broader research community. And it seems to be quite successful. The impact factor of a journal is relatively high. For every page of a research paper, there's about 0.5 page of comments. But interestingly, on this particular journal, about 75% of the reviewers choose to remain anonymous. Okay, so increasing transparency is one approach to improving peer review. Another one is to kind of focus on making it more efficient. And this is what happens on the Neuroscience Peer Review Consortia, and also happens on Biomed Central as well. So the idea here is to kind of cascade the peer review. So if an article is rejected, it then gets passed on to the next journal. So if you look at the experience of the Neuroscience Peer Review Consortia, it's an alliance of 37 neuroscience journals. And if an author is rejected from one of those journals and decides to submit to another journal, also in the alliance, they're invited to pass on the reviews to that second journal. So is it successful? Well, relatively, I guess. Modest success probably is the best way of classifying it. So about 5% of the authors take up the option. I think when I spoke to colleagues who are part of this, because Elsevier is part of this, one of the founding members, they really kind of categorised the kind of low take-up as being a lack of awareness in the community. And from the comments that they're getting back from the researchers, there's a sense that they want to have a fresh start, so they don't want to be burdened down by the previous reviews on the article. But where it did work, and those people did take it up, around about 36% had the decision on the next journal made without resorting to peer review. So there is an improved efficiency there. Okay, so finally, probably the most radical shift in peer review has been to remove peer review as a filter for quality in terms of importance and significance. And this is something that's practiced by PLOS ONE, and there's a whole suite of other journals over the last probably 12 to 18 months that now offer a very similar service. So Frontiers have moved on from what they were doing a year or so ago, so that they offer something very similar. We have Scientific Reports, Sage Open, Open Biology, and Biology Open. They are two different groups, honestly, I'll show you. And then we have another approach, which is actually just to publish any manuscript that has been rejected. And this is Rejecta Mathematica, which is quite a brave approach, I think, but nonetheless it's something that that's going on in the community at the moment. So I'm not going to speak too long about these different initiatives, because Mark's going to follow me and I'll give you a lot more detail about PLOS ONE. It's introduced back in December 2006. So as I understand it, and Mark will probably correct me on this, the acceptance rate is approximately around 70%. The number of research articles published in 2010 is 5,250. That's what it said on your site when I double-checked this morning. it's proven to be relatively successful, I think, is the key point here. It has an impact factor of 4.4, and the average number of downloads is, swing the average range around about 900. But on the kind of fundamental underlying principle with this approach is, you know, you remove the peer review as a filter, but then you allow the community to decide whether the research is impactful. And in this area, I suspect that it's still a little bit open because, you know, when we did just a sample of 120 articles in PLOS ONE, only 3% have ratings, user ratings, and around about 14% have reader comments. So this is the bit that's a little bit open, I would suggest. Reject the Mathematica very quickly. As I mentioned, it's a great concept, I think. So any kind of mathematician that submits to this journal actually has to provide a letter, an open letter, saying why they think their work is of value. Is it successful? Well, the inaugural issue was in July 2009. It had 6 articles. We had to wait 2 years for the next issue to come out. But it did, and it did come out, and it had 6 papers on it. Is that successful? I'm not quite sure. I don't believe it is. But nonetheless, you know, in publishing, we're experimenting, and that's the key message, I think. Okay, so that's the end of my presentation. I mean, I started it off by having a title, which is is it evolution or revolution? I pretty much come down on the side of it being evolution, but I would probably put it in the category of rapid evolution rather than evolution. Okay, thank you.